Welcome back to Wombology. It's day one of a round of 16. We are six games down, two to go. I'm your host, still Callum Leslie, still rank 10. And with me is Sottl, who I think has decayed in ranks throughout this cast. I don't know. I was legend when we started, but I think he's now hovering around rank 5.
Yeah, something around there. I don't know.
We'll check in with him throughout the broadcast.
Sorry, I'm just looking for this dead pixel I have on my forehead, because I was just hanging out in chat in a little bit in the break, and they pointed out to me that on source quality in the stream, there is a dead pixel like right here somewhere. But yeah, it's nothing to do with my webcam, guys. Like, I have no idea what's going on, so sorry. Like, that would trigger the hell out of me as well. So I apologize for it, but enough of that. Let's get into the match as soon as we can. Callum, do you have the lineups for us?
I do, and maybe we'll try and not make any mistakes in this one. We don't know how this cast has gone somewhat off the rails, but it's fine. Well, I mean, when they hired me, it was off the rails, but Salt has got worse. So, they've both banned Paladin. That's pretty easy. They both brought and banned Paladin. And then they both have Warrior and Druid. Life Coach has brought Warlock, and Purple has brought Mage. Neither of those particularly surprising to me, actually.
No.
I have to say those lineups relatively predictable.
Yeah, I guess the minor talking point here is that Purple has decided not to bring a Warlock with him, which, going back through the rest, so Ryzen didn't have a Warlock, Orange didn't have a Warlock. Everyone else, I believe, has brought Warlock. Yeah, so those are the only two so far. And just between, you know, between Zoo, between Reno Lock, even Demon Handlock, as we saw from Dog, and, you know, even like little wrinkles you can put in, like we've seen Purple play Malilock to amazing effect when he just made the God read that it was just meta dominant at a time when no one realized it was. And that's primarily what catapulted him to winning DreamHack. So between all these different options that you have for Warlock, you kind of always feel like one Warlock deck will be appropriate for your lineup. But Purple choosing not to go with it here, instead sneaking that Mage into his lineup alongside the common Warrior and Druid and Paladin that we've seen.
Yeah, absolutely. So Life Coach is going to start on the Warrior, and Purple is going to start on the Druid. And just to steal a joke from Sixel on Twitter, of course, we are about an hour and a half behind schedule, so we thought it was the perfect time to bring on Life Coach.
Yep.
It's exactly what you need when your tournament is running multiple hours behind schedule.
Yeah, Life Coach, Eater of Worlds, Destroyer of Schedules, single-handedly, but our schedule is already well and truly destroyed already, so I'm sure Life Coach can't do too much additional harm to us here.
The schedule is already dead.
Yeah.
It's already dead. So we're just going to keep bringing the Hearthstone until we're done with it, or we pass out. Whichever comes first, it's up in the air right now.
Yeah.
Two more to go, though. And two good ones as well. I mean, these are the two I've been really hyped for. I say Life Coach and Purple. We're going to get started with that game. It's going to be Life Coach and Warrior, Purple on Druid as soon as we can.
Looks like from our player feed, Life Coach has just wandered off for a little bit, though. So we're going to have to fill a little bit of time. But yeah. So it looks like Life Coach is going to open with Warrior here. Purple is going to open with Druid. Life Coach was a player who was a little bit late to the Patron train, I'd say. He didn't pick it up straight away. But when he decided that it was time to learn Patron, he did one of his standard Life Coach streams where he just sat there, played Patron, you know, screenshot every turn, went back in the VODs, analyzed every turn that he played. And, you know, this is his learning process and it works well for him. And he picks up Patron very, very quickly and is now one of the strongest Patron players in the world. So
I thought you were going to talk about when Life Coach decided he really liked Patron and decided he wanted to craft an all golden Patron deck.
Yeah.
And then got 29 cards down and looked for Golden Gnomish Inventor, realized he had to get Priest to level 60 and decided not to bother.
Yeah, which is probably a valid option. But yeah, Life Coach has picked up Patron, the old Warsong Patron, very, very quickly. Did it through help of Crane, who is a player that people are starting to get a little bit of exposure to now. He showed his face in PGL. He was invited to the G2 Class Legends tournament. This is a guy that's really behind the scenes as an unknown top player that was really helping out, particularly the G2 team, RDU and Life Coach, you know, labbing with them on Patron and really bringing them along in those decks, or in that deck specifically. So yeah, Life Coach, I would expect to see Patron Warrior here, but every time I've made a call on these lines, I've ended up being wrong. So in before Control Warrior, I guess, but looks like we're going to get Patron Warrior up against Druid as our game one here.
Yeah, that would be what we would expect, and let's have a look. Oh, well, we see...
Nope, never mind.
Yeah.
Oh, this is excellent.
So is this Control Warrior? Is this going to be something a little bit crazier?
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, there is still a weird outside world where he has Big Game Hunter and Bram Bronzebeard in his Patron Warrior for some reason, but I would suspect that this is some form of Control Warrior. And Life Coach, as always, with just about every decision, is going to take his time here, consider what he wants to keep. Purple, from his perspective, is probably pretty much done right now. We have.
Well, yeah, he's already locked in his mulligan.
Yeah, he's locked in his mulligan. Living Roots, Wild Growth, Pilot Shredder seems good.
But Life Coach, okay, he's going to keep the Armorsmith, which is pretty much what we expected. And gets double War Axe, double Armorsmith. Well, on the coin, that's...
Harrison Jones in Purple's Druid as well. This hand is looking pretty dreamy here from Purple, but... there was a statistic that I got once from a well-known player. I can't actually remember exactly who it was right now, but back in the days where Druid completely farmed Control Warrior, back in the days before, you know, Justicar came out and Bash came out and things like that, they helped stabilize the matchup a little bit. I was told by someone that the double Armorsmith start increased their win rate against Druid by something like 17%. Double Armorsmith start against Druid is what we see here. It doesn't seem like a thing that should have a huge impact because they do get dealt with very quickly by the large minions that come out early from Druid, but I guess just that initial little bit of board presence helping you tidy up Shredder drops, gain a bunch of armor in the process, etc. Just puts you in a really nice position to move forward.
What makes things a little bit more difficult is when you draw four weapons.
Yeah.
In seven cards.
Yeah. He's just going to choose to take out the 1-1 here. He could have double traded into the 3-2 and just had a 1-1 left on board, but then the remaining 1-1 just trades into the remainder of his remaining Armorsmith. So I like this line just to leave the 3-2 in play, but the Harrison Jones comes out, punishes that War Axe immediately. No hesitation from Purple there, destroying the War Axe instead of the more valuable Death Spire. What do you think about that?
I think he's going to see a little bit of a punish here because Life Coach does have so many weapons, but I like it for getting tempo on the board and getting a minion on the board that can deal with the Armorsmiths as well.
Yeah, I think what was important that turn from Purple's perspective is that his options were basically Harrison Jones or pass.
Yeah,
so, like,
exactly.
Harrison Jones was on curve, it hit a weapon, it drew a card, he now has a Dr. Boom that he can rush out here, but choosing to hero power down the Armorsmith first instead of using Innovate as a coin to get the boom out, develops his shade onto the board, gets this down early enough that it can still be a reasonable threat later on. And the Fierce Monkey in Control Warrior is very much a Life Coach twist.
Yeah, I was going to say, Life Coach was one of the first people to do that.
Yeah.
With the Fierce Monkey.
It's a valid card. It's a lot of board control early on. It's a card that I've seen some people even play in like mid-range patron decks. Sometimes even in place of Frothing Berserker, just to have the stronger vanilla stats. But it's a card that was printed and people immediately viewed and thought, well, you know, this is objectively a good card. There's no dispute about that. It's just, does it have a place in the decks, you know, where we want to see them? And so far it has been struggling to find a home a little bit, but maybe with the introduction of Standard, Fierce Monkey is one of those high quality cards that can come in.
Yeah, I've seen some people maybe play it in Patron in place of Dread Corsair.
Yeah, that too. Yeah, for sure.
As you say, just a stronger stat line on the taunt there.
Yeah.
Than 3 health, 4 health, getting a little bit more work done.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, as you say, it's a life coach twist that he put into his Warrior decks quite quickly. I do find it interesting the evolution of Hearthstone. Of Hearthstone metas and cards and that sort of thing, that if you remember when the first 3-mana 3/4 was printed, which was in Naxx for Priest with Dark Cultist, everyone went, holy crap, this stat line is amazing, we've never had this.
Yeah,
this is great.
Yeah,
and then of course we got Spider Tank after that,
right?
And now Fierce Monkey with the 3/4 with taunt is pretty nice.
Yeah, I think Reynard went as far to say that, like, Dark Cultist was going to break the game and it was just too powerful, it was the best card in the game, etc., all this stuff. But, like, if you think about it, the vanilla 3-mana 3-4 hasn't existed, but that's always been the vanilla stat line for a 3-mana minion, according to the power curve. Because all the 3-3s have beneficial abilities, which means, by extension, 3-mana 3-4 is correct. It's just that one hadn't existed up until the point where they started printing them, so... You know, it wasn't too much of a power creep or anything like that. It's just a stat line that was missing from the game, same as the 5-mana 5/6 that we eventually saw with Pit Fighter.
Yeah, and lots of various other nice stat lines we got in the TDT expansion, like North Sea Kraken and captured Jormungr. So probably going for the Thorazin here, even though it dies to the Death Spite, I guess just to get the reduction on combo.
Yep, I mean, he does discount his combo pieces here, and he is going to go ahead and just jam that Shade in to ask for the extra source of removal here from Life Coach. Varian Wrynn!
That's interesting.
What is happening? The Azure Drake as well means that this is probably Dragon Warrior that we're looking at.
Do you think he watched the Curse Trials and just went, you know what? Like it. I'll have it.
Here's the thing, Dragon Warrior just didn't perform in that entire tournament. It was a running joke from the casters and in chat how awful Dragon Warrior was performing. So seems entirely bizarre that he'd bring a warrior deck with things like Azir Drake, Varian Wrynn into this format on purpose. But who knows what's running through Life Coach's mind to...
Who knows what at any given time is running through Life Coach's mind?
Yeah.
I see purple Mana After Your Own Heart revealing that Shade, just hitting face with it at 4 damage, not keeping it stealth and being too greedy.
And he's going to get paid for it here. There's no source of removal for it in the hand. Already attacked with a Deathbite this hand, so... Force of Nature, Savage Roar cannot go fade. Force of Nature, Savage Roar plus this 5 damage here, so he's going to have 14, 19, 21 damage. That's just lethal. End of the game.
Absolutely. Combo is going to deal the damage. I mean, purple, you know, we say he just revealed the Shade because he didn't want to be too greedy, but he also did it to set up lethal.
Exactly.
Very heads up on him.
Yep. And so you see he is 1 point over lethal here, so without that 4 that he dug in on the previous turn, he would not have had enough damage for lethal here. So great recognition to get the Shade in. Knew if it couldn't get removed, then it set up the lethal damage.
Absolutely. So we won't get to see any more of that Life Coach Warrior. I'm really intrigued to know what it's like. Hopefully we might get to see some more later on, or maybe see the list at Lair Day. Interesting. I was going to say one of my other favorite bits of Hearthstone trivia, Hearthstone fact, that many people maybe don't realize is when you do something like Emperor Thorazin on a 0 mana cost card or below 0, it actually gets a negative mana cost.
Yes. Yeah.
The Innervate technically costs -1, but only shows a 0. Yep. But if your opponent were to then play a Lotheb, it would only go up to 4, not 5.
Yeah, I have had an absolute nonsense game before when I've played an Innervate under Lotheb conditions for 1 mana. Just because I could. It still gave me a mana, right? It was still net positive at the end of the day, so I figured I might as well play it. But yeah, I got like 4 ticks of Emperor that game. So unsurprisingly, as a druid, I won.
Yeah. Lots of animals on stream today. We had Pidgey, and we have one of your cats now over your shoulder.
Oh, hey, buddy. What's up?
Mine hasn't made an appearance yet. She does like to climb in front of the camera, so if she does, everyone will know about it.
Fair enough. Looks like we are about ready to get into game 2 here, and looks like Life Coach has decided that the Druid Mirror is his best choice here. What was his alternate option? He could have gone Warlock. With Warlock. So yeah, that makes sense. It seems like Life Coach, in that case, has a control Warlock.
It would make sense. Life Coach does play a lot. He played a lot of Handlock back in the day, but does play a lot of control Warlock.
So last time, purple hit Living Roots, Wild Growth, Shredder. This time, the hand not so good. The only common card this time is the Harrison Jones, and that Harrison Jones is not going to be anywhere near as effective in this opening hand as it was in the previous one.
No. Innervate Shade on turn 1. Thoughts?
In this hand, maybe not. It is very, very valuable to get turn 1 Shade down in the Druid matchup particularly, because they have no way of interacting with Shade of Naxxramas. So if you get it down on turn 1, you can let it grow as much as you want. You can pick your turn to attack.
The only way a Druid can kill it is Azure Drake or spell damage swipe.
Yeah, and on the turn it comes out.
Yeah, right? Exactly.
So, like, once it starts growing, then it's GG. But looking at this hand, to me, the curve says Innervate Shredder into Shade. So that would be the line I would go with here, but I understand the merits of forcing out the Shade of Naxxramas as early as possible in this matchup.
Yeah, so you know, you can meme about Life Coach roping on turn 1, but there's actually a...
Yeah, there is a genuine decision to make here, and Life Coach is going to go with the Innervate Shade line here. This is the line with Druid that I saw him taking a lot in the G2 Class Legends tournament, where he would leave himself, use his ramp cards in a way that he'd leave himself without something to do on the following turn, and then rip that perfect something to do every time. So Wild Growth Inc. That works too.
Oh,
boom.
There we go.
Nailed it.
Life coached it.
Yeah. Looks like he's considering whether or not he plays it. Okay. I mean, sure. I mean, the consideration here is for the amount of live draws you have if you hold this innovate. I think we had this exact situation come up before, where holding on to this means that next turn, any five drop you draw, you can play with the innovate and then you curve out into Shredder.
I think it was a coin innervate boom.
Right. Yeah, something like
that. On turn four.
Yeah. But yeah, Life Coach is just going to go straight ahead and innovate here for the maximum ball presence. But he is kind of sat with a Savage Roar and a Dream right now. So he's going to want to be able to draw relatively well here. But that Shredder is just going to start beating away.
I mean, that's playable.
It's playable, but it's playable. If you're going to play it, you probably do want to get it out right now because it's one turn before your opponent can start swiping you. So it seems like a good turn to draw it, if any. Just get it on the board, and you also have that Savage Roar to back it up if they survive.
Yeah. So if they do survive, the shape goes to 5. So you have 5 plus 4, 9, 11, plus 10. So that's 21 maths.
Next turn he'd have 9 plus 1 plus 1 plus 10. Yeah, 21. Next turn with the Savage Roar.
So, you know, it's not lethal, but frankly, on turn 4, it's far closer than it should be.
Oh, Purple, I love you. Just get stuck right in with that shade, straight to the face.
That was Life Coach.
Oh, yeah, sorry, Life Coach, my bad. I was looking at Purple's beautiful face at the time, so maybe the sentiment was genuine, but not for the reasons that were intended. Yeah.
But it's a very good decision, I think. You know, it's exactly the same reason that playing the Living Roots this turn is good.
Yeah.
It survives the swipe.
Yeah.
So you can reveal it, and your opponent can do very little about it. In fact, we see Purple can do nothing except play a BGH and trade the shade into the Shredder.
Yeah, and the magical number that we both calculated last turn was 21, and the alternate, again, byproduct of that shade attack is that he puts his opponent to 21. So unless the trade game is made here, he's going to be in the position for lethal, but Purple does go ahead and trade. He's going to be able to now hero power down this 2-1. So we are left with the Shade growing to 5, 6, 7, plus 8, so 15 damage this turn. Yeah.
Here's the other part of the combo.
All right. Hero Power pass for 5 more turns, and we're good. Now, I'm relatively confident that this Savage Roar gets invested this turn, because now you know that Swipe is a threat. Swipe, of course, doesn't deal with that Shade, but there's also the potential that Keeper of the Grove can come down and silence it, so this is potentially the most damage that Savage Roar ever does, so I would like to see this jammed into Purple's face right now.
Yep, Life Coach is going to go for it. As you say, 15, not the 21 that would have gotten the lethal here, but... Yep. And Purple is going to go ahead and
concede.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Wow, turn 4, Druid Mirror win for Life Coach. And Life Coach's gamble of picking into that Druid Mirror has absolutely paid off for him here.
Yeah, I mean, it probably wasn't much of a gamble if his other option was a Control Warlock of some variety, Reno Lock or Handlock. It was just the solid pick to go with. It's just an unfortunate situation from his perspective that, you know, his best matchup to come back to try and counter was a 50-50, but we did see things like Harrison Jones in Purple's deck, which reduces his efficiency in that matchup in particular. So Life Coach was able just to get that clutch draw, again, just trusting in his deck to draw him something to do, you know, making the ramp play that left him without a turn 2 play, and then top decking the innovate to get the Shredder in play was just way too much initiative on the board. Savage Roar sealed it out on turn 4.
Gotta believe in the heart of the cards.
Yep.
He did. And it worked. So there you go. So 1-1 now. The mage, it looks like, for Purple, against the Druid of Life Coach, and the Warlock remaining for Life Coach in the back pocket, Purple with his Warrior. Is Purple likely to be playing Patron?
Purple is an adept Patron player. He had it in his DreamHack winning lineup. It was part of that lineup alongside the Malagos Rogue, so he's definitely more than capable of bringing that deck, but I've been burned too many times at this point, Caleb. I don't know, but did you say he's picked his Mage here, did you say?
Yeah.
He's picked his Mage into the Druid.
Yeah.
Which suggests we might be about to see the first Tempo Mage of the day.
Well, I was going to say, I mean, the Tempo Mage... I feel like the Tempo Mage is more popular in North America than in Europe, and the Freeze Mage is more popular in Europe, because we saw at the America's Championship a lot of Tempo Mage, whereas basically no Tempo Mage, I think, in Europe, and lots of freeze mage in Europe and none in Americas. But yeah, we can see it's going to be temple mage.
Yeah, I know that the freeze mage list that we've seen recently that's been relatively popular, the double roaring torch, no Antonidas build, I believe was pioneered by Cross again, who we spoke about earlier with the secret paladin build. He, I know, said that he had something like 70% win rate against Druid with that deck. So, I mean, I don't think that's personally representative, and sure, Cross is just a really good player. He had a favorable win rate, great, but there was a chance that maybe Purple was playing a Freeze Mage list that he felt comfortable against Druid with, but having now seen the Mulligans, that Mana Worm, Mad Scientist, Frostbolt in hand, this is a Tempo Mage 101 opening hand here, and Tempo Mage, very effective at dealing with what Druid wants to do. It just doesn't ever let them get that board presence developed. Too many early minions, too much early pressure. Flame Cannon being such an effective answer to Shade of Nexramas, one of the best answers in the game. It's usually just able to accelerate past what Druid can keep up with.
While the Mana Worm opening for Purple feels pretty good, doesn't have a spell to back it up with just now, but he does have the Flame Cannon for anything Life Coach may play in. And this does go back to our conversation earlier about Darnassus Aspirant.
Sure.
Is that there are so many classes with so many options to deal with Darnassus Aspirant. And it got to the point where if you're playing against Druid, you always mulligan for those answers. So Mage is going to mulligan for Flame Cannon Frostbolt. Warrior is going to mulligan for Fiery War Axe. And it just makes it not worth your while to play the Darnassus Aspirant.
Yep, very much so. You can see, if Lycoach had an Aspirant in his hand there instead of a Wild Growth, you know, the Aspirant would have got played. It would have immediately got Frostbolted or Flame Cannoned. The mana would have been lost. The Mana Worm would have been pushing much more damage. So, Wild Growth, a much more consistent card overall, but as Firebat mentioned when he really popularized that first Aspirantless Druid deck a little while ago, Aspirant is a card that you can bring back in once your opponent isn't expecting it and stops mulliganing for those Frostbolts and the Fiery War Axe. That's when it comes back in and becomes really powerful.
Yeah, you can see here, if Life Coach had an Aspirant, and we didn't see Aspirants from either of these players actually in their Druid lists, from what we've seen, that the either Frostbolt but likely Flame Cannon would have punished it pretty heavily. In fact, two Flame Cannons.
Yeah.
More than enough Flame Cannons. And the Flame Cannon punish might work on the Keeper of the Grove here, though.
Looks like Life Coach is going to bail out here and just decide to wrath down that Mana Worm. It's starting to get to the point. The coin is still in hand as well, so the range of plays that Purple can possibly make to start buffing up that Mana Worm and pushing through damage is pretty wide at this point. So goes ahead and wraths it. And this is a thing that you can definitely try and do against Tempo Mage in the early game, where if you play the removal game, because they play so many cheap synergistic spells, if you're able to kill one or two of the minions that they play early on, they might get choked with this sort of situation in their hand where they just have, you know, Arcane Blasts, Arcane Missiles, Flame Cannons, Frostbolts, etc. Nothing to cast them on. So that's probably the line that Life Coach was going to go down there. And it would have worked if it wasn't for the top-decked Water Elemental from Purple.
Yeah, I was just going to say, Water Elemental, really interesting deck choice. You don't always see it. It's very much a minority pick. I remember talking to Raynad about a Blingtron Mech Mage deck that he's playing with Water Elementals, because you wanted maximum opportunities to freeze your opponent's face when you gave them the weapon. But you don't see it too often in Temple Mage. But I mean, we talked about stat lines earlier,
right?
It's a really good minion.
It's becoming more and more common. There's actually a lot of things going for Water Elemental in the current meta. There's a decent amount of Patron Warrior around, there's a ton of Paladin around, and there's a ton of Piloted Shredder around. And against all of those things, Water Elemental is a pretty effective answer. You can freeze out the Muster Weapon, you can freeze out the True Silvers and the Cog Hammers and the Death Spites, and you also have one of the very few stat lines in the game which is genuinely favorable against Piloted Shredder.
Second Flame Cannon decision here. I'm seeing they got the Giblin Stalker. One Flame Cannon to deal with the Piloted Shredder, and then seeing the drop. Well, there's nothing else you can do about it. You can't trade into it, so
yeah.
I guess you're going to use the second Flame Cannon. But yeah, Purple lucky to have the two Flame Cannons there.
Yeah, this is from Purple's perspective at least, this is going to line up pretty well because he has the option to now, into the minions that Druid plays this turn, trade his Mad Scientist so he gets the threat of a Mirror Entity in play into Druid turn 7. Unfortunately, looking at Life Coach's hand, he doesn't really have proactive stuff to play this turn, so that Mad Scientist is not going to die on the turn that Purple was probably trying to engineer it to, and he's just going to have to make do with just an Azure Dracon curve here, which I guess you can't be too sad about.
Just an Azure Dracon curve.
Yep.
And we see some potential shenanigans next turn with Flame Waker, Sorcerer's Apprentice, and the Frostbolt. If you could pick up something like Arcane Missiles or Mirror Images.
Yeah, Arcane Blast, lots of options for a zero mana spell with Sorcerer's Apprentice, but this is well navigated from Life Coach in the end, because we saw him early on considering whether to silence that Mad Scientist with the Keeper of the Grove when he decided to Wrath the Mana Worm instead. Mirror Entity is just such a destructive card against Druid, because if there's no Aspirant in the deck, Zombie Chow is a thing long of the past in Druid decks these days, so there really aren't these good targets to proc the Mirror Entity with. And I really think Purple was trying to engineer the situation where that Mirror Entity, if he is running it, was pulled into play into the turn 7. Because it wasn't, Life Coach now has the opportunity to develop the minion.
Yeah, there's... If you don't play the Aspirant, there's actually... It's the first time for a long time, I think. Or it's throughout the history of Hearthstone, it becomes quite uncommon that there's not a 2-drop in Druid.
Yeah.
So for a long time, people were playing things like Haunted Creeper in mid-range Druid. Some people put things like Sunfear Protector in there, just as a 2-mana 2/3 in the early game, mostly.
Yeah, back in the Spectral Knight days, mostly, because Taunting Up Spectral Knight was just such a nuisance in the meta back then.
Yeah, but it also meant you had a 2-mana 2/3 right. in the early game. But if you're not playing the Aspirant, you don't have anything in that low mana slot. All you have is Shade, and then your 4-drops.
Yeah, absolutely. So the secret is now pulled into play. So usually we're looking at Counterspell, Mirror Entity. Duplicate has started to become more popular because of the situation you see now, where the Tempo Mage burns themselves out of cards with all the cheap synergistic little spells they play. So Duplicate has started to become a little bit more popular, but still Counterspell and Mirror Entity are pretty much the core of the deck. So Life Coach will need to decide how he wants to navigate this.
Well, I mean... You obviously want to try and get the Keeper of the Grove copied, right? Because that's the lowest value creature you have. So you can silence the Flame Waker, and then it's so difficult because there's merits to getting rid of all three minions on board.
Yeah, for sure.
Obviously, the highest immediate power is Azure Drake, but you could do something like silence Sorcerer's Apprentice, swipe Flame Waker, for example.
Yeah, there's a lot of considerations as to what you want to leave up on the board here. Like, leaving Sorcerer's Apprentice up means that you can potentially let your opponent start refilling their hand really cheaply if one of those cards is Arcane Intellect. You know, leaving Azure Drake up, it's the biggest body and it has spell damage, but Flame Waker essentially has spell damage too with its missile effect and is much more scary, so he's going to leave behind the Flame Waker, thinks that's what he can get away with here, but the Unstable Portal play here is going to start to punish him, picks up a zero mana Mad Scientist, ends up paying 2 mana for it with the cost of the Unstable Portal. Going to go ahead and conjure a first here. Don't see his options, unfortunately, but yeah, Purple will be pretty happy to have paid 2 mana for a Mad Scientist.
Exactly. It's a new Mad Scientist. And I guess a Forgotten Torch from the Arcanist. That's not bad at all.
Yeah, that's really nice.
So things are lining up well for Purple. I mean, Life Coach all the way down on 12 health as well.
Yeah, and he's going to have to find an answer to this. He gets the information based on his play last turn that this is Mirror Entity that he's dealing with. Of course, remember, there is a secret up right now. It's just hidden behind the overlay. Mad Scientist got popped, and then he cast Force of Nature, which went off successfully, so no counterspell. And after killing the minions, Effigy or Duplicate, neither of those went off. So he gets the sad news that this is the bane of Druid's existence, the Mirror Entity. And he just has nothing in his hand here that he'd want to proc it with, so... Azure Drake swipe is potentially a good combination, but not enough to deal with the board here. So it looks like he's going to give over the low value Keeper of the Grove here. As you said, that's the thing that you want copied. You can then follow that up with a swipe to at least keep some sort of control on the board.
Yeah, you can do okay here with it because you can do the 2 damage to the Arcanist and then swipe the Flame Waker. So you'll leave the 2/4 and the Mad Scientist, which isn't the worst. And you will, of course, get the... Well, yeah, you leave the 2/4 on your own side as well. Well, there's a fireball.
Yeah,
that is lethal.
I didn't see the top deck he picked it up so quickly, but I assumed it was fireball from how quickly he picked it up. And yeah, that is going to get the job done. Purple here. Good. Paying out here, bringing Tempo Mage to the tournament. First time we've seen it in anyone's lineup so far today, but he benefits from just having that natural counter to the Druid that's been so dominant throughout.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about Purple's ability to read the meta and the strong decision making and the strong deck building. We, you know, talked about this Malygos Warlock in DreamHack Winter. It's perhaps that he has made a similar read that everyone is playing Druid right now because all everyone is talking about is how strong Druid is.
Callum, let's put things in perspective here. His meta read to bring the Malygos Warlock to DreamHack was phenomenally good. A bunch of people afterwards were like, well, yeah, of course it was going to be good. Like, hell? But like, no one had the foresight. No one did it beforehand. Making the read that a lot of people are going to bring Druid to a tournament right now is not quite as advanced.
Yeah, okay, but making the read that people are going to bring Druid, but then to tailor your lineup with bringing Temple Mage, as opposed to bringing Druid yourself and some other strong decks, right, which is what everyone else seems to have done.
Yeah.
They've seemed to have gone, well, I'll just Druid harder, and I'll get ahead of it somehow.
I mean, a lot of people have had the Zoo as their counter for that sort of thing, which, you know, you can put out there, but I think Tempo Mage is even a harder counter than Zoo is.
Yeah.
Zoo can get blown out by those early, like, Living Roots into Wild Growth into Keeper kind of draws, whereas Tempo Mage has the tools to deal even with that. So, yeah, the Tempo Mage is probably the most intelligent pick if you are looking just to deliberately force Druid out of the tournament, and as I said, Purple gets rewarded here for his foresight.
So the Control Warlock, which Life Coach steered away from earlier, went for the Druid Mirror instead. How does that line up now against the Temple Mage?
You just blanked out there for a second. Can you repeat the question?
Sorry, the Control Warlock that Life Coach veered away from,
right,
in picking against the Druid,
yeah,
he now has to pick it into the Temple Mage. How does that line up for him?
It's a better matchup than the Druid, for sure. It can still struggle, but a lot of it comes down to the timing of the burn draws from the Mage deck. They really want to draw into those fireballs on like the crucial game-ending turns and just consolidate minion pressure on the turns before that. Sorcerer's Apprentice and two Flamewakers is a pretty solid opening hand in this matchup. But yeah, a lot of it comes down to how the Tempo Mage draws and whether they're able to keep up minion pressure on the board throughout the mid game when the Warlock notoriously starts to fight back with their board clears, whether they have the refills to keep going with that, whether they hit enough card draw, and then the timing on when they draw that game-ending burn is really crucial.
Absolutely. We see a pretty decent start for Purple as well. Gets the Sorcerer's Apprentice, Flamewaker, Water Elemental. No spells for those two, but even just being able to curve like that, the, you know, a 2-4 on turn 3 is not bad, and Flamewaker does demand a response.
It certainly does. It's a minion. It's a minion that's on that elite must kill list in Hearthstone, yeah, which consists of, you know, Flamewaker, Gadgetzan Auctioneer, Knife Juggler. You know, this is the sort of company that you're in. It does demand a response. But
the Corruption feels like a pretty good counter to Water Elemental.
It's not bad. I mean, the other two minions are extremely low value as well.
Yeah.
Southsea Deckhand isn't going to get anything done in terms of weapon charge. And Secret Keeper is a potential counter, because of course it does get buffed when your opponent plays secrets as well.
True.
But it's probably not valid enough. You may just want to take the Corruption here. It's, again, one of those situations with Discover where a really bad card in Hearthstone is sometimes exactly what you want.
I mean, how else, if the Water Elemental does come out in turn 4, how else do you deal with it without sinking a ton of damage into it?
Right. I
mean, it's actually probably the neatest way you can deal with it.
Yeah, I mean, you could have minions on board and, you know, combine that together with a Dark Bomb or something, but yeah, it's not going to be clean, so you're right, Corruption might get the job done pretty well here. And Purple just willing to accept the trade here into the 2-2 instead of using the Flame Cannon. Sorcerer's Apprentice, another really high-value minion in this deck that can get a lot of tempo going for you, but Purple deciding just to throw it away here and maintain that Flame Cannon in his hand with the two Flame Wakers, valuing that higher than the 3-2 Sorcerer's Apprentice.
Does Life Coach consider the Dark Bomb here to punish?
I'm not sure. The Dark Bomb can be used, but I know Life Coach is also a big fan of that button that draws you cards, so he might just decide to draw another card here and take the trade on the board. You know, Dark Bomb is a card that will get some work done in this matchup at some point. It can hit a Piloted Shredder. Obviously, we've seen the War Elementals from Purple, which makes the Shredder less common to be on the board. But there's considerations here to be made for sure, because this 2-2 on the board is going to start to lose value very quickly. So yeah, Life Coach ends up going with the Life Tap trade play.
And yeah, I think we, especially since you've got the two Flamewakers, Flamewaker and Curve, not bad at all.
Yeah, Flame Waker on curve for sure here. But now Life Coach's little bit of discipline there to hold on to the Dart Bomb is going to pay off, because, as we said, this is a minion that demands attention. And if he does feel the need to remove it here, he now has the Dart Bomb Mortal Coil combo to take it down.
Yeah, and that definitely feels like a strong play. And then you've got Shredder for turn four. Unfortunately, the Water Elemental is, as we talked about a couple of times, a really good answer to Piloted Shredder. But I don't know what else Life Coach could do. Do you think he does play the Shredder into the Elemental? Or does he maybe look at tap and maybe just something like the Sun Fury Protector?
Yeah, I mean, on average, Shredder and Water Elemental trade one for one with each other. You know, the 3-6 goes in, and on average, it's like a 2-2-ish minion that comes out before you get into decimals. So they trade into each other pretty much. So it's not a terrible play to just jam the Shredder into the Water Elemental. But Jeff, I mean, if he picks up, an Imp Gang boss, he might choose to maybe Corruption and play the Imp Gang boss instead, or he might just end up doing Corruption tap here. But that Corruption being picked, I think you're right in your analysis earlier on. I think this would have been with a consideration of having seen Water Elemental come out earlier.
Of course, Life Coach is going to take his time.
Oh, of course.
He did think about it three turns ago, but he's still got to rope this turn as well to make sure he does it correctly.
Yeah, for sure. So the two valid options here seem to be Piloted Shredder or Tap Corruption. So I think we're deciding between those two here, but, you know, Life Coach, one of the benefits of him considering every single line on every single turn is that he does sometimes come up with something a little bit wacky that you aren't expecting, but makes a lot of sense when you really dig deep down into what he's doing. But looks like it is going to be the Life Tap Corruption play.
Yep, good. Picks up Power Overwhelming on the Life Tap as well, and has Lothed for turn 5, which is going to be a really good way of controlling this board, I think. Especially if, yeah, Purple doesn't get a spell out here. So he's going to be relying on wanting to do spells next turn. Seems like a good time to play the Lothed, but also the Fugin's in hand, which is the 4-7.
Yeah, what's interesting to me is, I wanted to say he tapped last turn into Power Overwhelming. He's running Power Overwhelming in what appears to just be the control version of the list. Like, Fugin, Stalag Fugin and the Burst combo very rarely show up in the same deck.
Yeah, I don't think it's too unusual to just play a Power Overwhelming.
It has a lot of value in the deck. You know, you do have things like Imp Gang Boss, you do have Shadow Flame, you have Sylvanas, which Sylvanas Power Overwhelming is a really powerful combo at times, just to steal one huge target like Tyrion or something. But yeah, it's a card that is a little bit less common when you're not playing the Burst combo with Faceless, and it seems to suggest that Life Coach isn't. But Loetheb is pretty solid here to come down and lock out any Flame Waker value. But Purple is going to establish dominance as the aggressor here and refuse to trade into the 5-2 with the Flame Waker, try and get his 2-3 damage in by going face.
Yeah, this is an interesting one. What do you do here if you're Life Coach?
There's always a feeling as a Hearthstone player, a stubborn feeling, that you want to try and find a play when your opponent does this that doesn't involve trading the 5-2 back into the 2-4, because you feel like they've got one over you on you in that situation. When someone like correctly makes that attack to face, they're like, you're going to trade anyway, so I'm going to hit your face. You immediately want to get stubborn and like, no, I'm not going to trade, I'm going to find something else. But unfortunately, I think trade is probably the play here.
And it's difficult because you can't... Well, you can, but the obvious follow-up is to trade and then go, well, it's okay, I can trade because I can just play Sylvanas and put something on the board. But actually against Mage, you know, there's Flame Cannon, Frostbolt, and Fireball in hand. You know, Flame Cannon ping, Frostbolt plus something else, like Flame Cannon or whatever, or Arcane Blast, and the Fireball are all ways to deal with that. And actually... Okay. Life Coach went for the Taunt and Shredder. That's interesting.
Yeah,
I mean, the Mirror Entity was up.
Yeah, exactly. I let you rock with the Sylvanas there for a second, but I was about to come in and say the Mad Scientist did die on the previous turn, so he saw Mirror Entity in the previous game. So very, very slim chance that Sylvanas was going to get slammed on the board. So the Sun Fury into Piloted Shredder play lets him trade with the minion. Sucks it up and accepts that Purple was right there to go face and got his 2-3 extra damage in, and Life Coach just went for the Shredder on the board.
Can't see the secret. It's not my fault.
Yeah.
So, dueling 2-1s on the board now. Mm-hmm. Again, there is the option of the trade, but also something like an Implosion, which I quite like. I like the possibility of Implosion because Demon Wrath's still in the hand. So it does give you the ability to, you know, if purple were to play Flame Waker and Sorcerer's Apprentice somehow the next turn, you could really easily deal with that board with the Demon Wrath and the Implosion.
Yeah, I think Life Coach is potentially looking at the possibility of Sylvanas Power Overwhelming on a following turn. He just moused over those two cards in his hand. He's considering, you know, it's about this time that potentially Antonidas could come down and start within the next couple of turns, Antonidas alongside one or two spells. So Sylvanas Power Overwhelming, of course, is a great answer to that. So it looks like he is just going to play the Sylvanas right now, and he's going to use that to proc the second Mirror Entity, and after trading, is he just going to Power Overwhelm that Sylvanas just so he steals the Mirror Entity? Yes, he is. Okay. So he's actually considering it for this turn, which puts him in the position that you described on the previous turn, Callum, which is the Sylvanas against an empty board, which can now just get sniped down by a fireball for no value.
I was just being forward-thinking.
Yep.
Yeah, there's Fireball is an option. There's also Frostbolt and Arcane Blast. Just goes for the... Oh, leaves the Sylvanas up.
Yeah, just leaves it up. Sat there, has the 6-3 sat there to trade with it, potentially. One of the ways you can get an edge against Reno Lock is just consistently make them have things. Because of the way the deck is built, right? They just naturally have things half as often as normal decks. So this is a deck that you'd... this is a play that you'd make rarely against a normal Warlock deck, because there'd be, you know, two Dark Bombs, maybe an Implosion as well, like all these things that could answer this 6-3 and punish you. But in this situation, you feel a lot more confident because of the deck makeup of your opponent's deck to make these riskier plays. And he's now building up that burn damage in hand with the double Fireball Frostbolt to be able to potentially push through lethal. Gets the 3 roll on the Implosion, so the punish is there, Sylvanas is consolidated. And Purple's going to have to decide how committed he is to this line of holding all his burn to go face.
Yep, so it does get the Implosion, as you say. And we'll see if he... a Life Tap would be a reasonable play here, though. You know. Let's see if... Yeah, gets the Siphon Soul, so that's another good pickup. Will help him deal with things like this Azure Drake that might come down, or, you know, that Azure Drake as well. The other one...
All right, so he does concede that the Sylvanas eventually needed fireballing there. Picks up the Doctor Boom, but there is the Big Game Hunter in hand. There was a little bit of a tap last Ellie Giggle situation from Life Coach in the previous turn. Cast his Implosion first, but he probably wanted to see what his Implosion outcome was first before he decided on the rest of his turn. But the Siphon Soul would have been a valid consideration, being the card that he tapped into there for just the really nice clean answer, but... Yeah. Again, Siphon Soul is a nice card to have as a potential answer to an Antonidas as well later on.
I think you do still go for the Implosion even if you do get the Siphon Soul from
I agree.
The tap. You feel a bit... You would definitely feel bad if it rolled two.
Yeah.
But I think you probably still just... The amount of value versus Siphon Soul.
Yeah. Especially having seen both Flame Wakers played early. These Imps are a lot more threatening on the board than they are normally against a Tempo Mage, because there isn't just the threat of, say, Flame Waker Arcane Missiles coming out and sweeping them almost guaranteed. So,
especially with the Argus coming out as well, that, you know, if you wanted to, he could buff two of them, which would be a little bit of protection against Flame Waker, should there still be Flame Wakers, which, of course, there are not. So, Life Coach actually stabilizing quite well here into a good position, but... Actually, the amount of stuff being picked up by Purple here, the Boom, Arcane Blast, Frostbolt.
The Arcane Blast tempo is real this turn. He has a total of 8 damage for 2 mana this turn if he wants it, with that Azure Drake buff being doubled.
So how much damage can he actually do?
Arcane Blast can only hit minions, so he's going to use this to take out the... Oh, he's going to save the second one and just generate the Doctor Boom instead of the Drake. That's interesting. So he looks like he's holding on to the second Drake Arcane Blast combination for later.
Oh, well, there is the combo then, Arcane Golem.
Yeah, interesting. This is not something that I've seen before, honestly. I don't know if Life Coach has been playing this recently, but not personally a variation of this deck that I've seen with both the Burst combo and the Fugue and Stalag suite included.
Yeah, the Fugue and Stalag suite and the full complement of AoE with Demon Wrath and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Demon Wrath is a card that I think would be high on the list to cut if you're wanting to put the combo in.
Yeah, I mean, you've got to make room for it somewhere, so it'd be interesting as to what has been cut from this list. You're looking at maybe candidates like the Molten Giants have possibly been left out. There's a lot of options that you have to adjust a Reno deck again, just by the nature of it. There's so many different cards that you can flex in and out, but Again, not a variant that I'm particularly familiar with seeing with both the twins and the full combo.
Well, this is a pretty tough position for purple here. I don't know if he plays Flamestrike, but I think he's probably wishing he did right now.
Yeah, there's an element of that where sometimes you almost get tilted enough to put a Flamestrike in your tempo mage, but then you very quickly realize that's a horrible idea and take it out again. So
yeah, you just have that one match on ladder where you just like, if you'd had a Flamestrike, you would have won against someone who didn't deserve to beat you.
Yeah.
You go to your deck creation, you go, I'm going to put a Flamestrike. No.
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 You queue into like five patron warriors in a row who all make patrons on turn 7, and then you go and put a Flamestrike in your deck, don't play against a patron for the rest of the day. Standard stuff.
Well, this is looking like it could well be our next 5-game series. Don't want to speak too soon, because Purple does still have a very good chance here. Life Coach is having a... giving him a good fight here. This has been the story of the day, that no one's going down without a fight, I think.
Can Purple find a win condition here? He probably is considering Frostbolting that Dr. Boom just to prevent the damage, but no, he's going to Frostbolt face just so he has lethal next turn if his opponent does not. This definitely sets up a potential win, but you're asking for 5 damage from your opponent. Looking at Life Coach's hand right now, there is only 4. So Boombot RNG could win the game, a Life Tap could win the game, otherwise he has to go for a defensive play. And the Alexstrasza that he just picked up is potentially a very powerful defensive play.
Yeah, I mean, when that came off the top, that was what I was thinking, that instantly you want to play a little bit safe and heal up, but also, you know, set yourself up with an 8-8 on the board, so it's not that defensive in many ways.
Yeah.
And you require a big answer.
Worth knowing he's also 1 mana off the glorious Twisting Nether lethal here, which is one of the most fun things you can ever do in Reno Lock. Where you hit face with everything and then you just Twisting Nether at the end so the Boombots kill them. But, like, unfortunately, to guarantee that, he'd need to be able to play the Arcane Golem as well, which obviously doesn't fit into the mana. It's actually a relatively common way of ending games with this deck, believe it or not.
Oh, so he's going to be 1-off.
Damage off, yeah. He lost 2 damage from the Boombots, so it going face for 2 damage just left the whole thing to come out in the wash. So, going to make the defensive Alex play. You see Purple's face in his hands there. Mortified by that Alexstrasza coming down, and that is probably him out of the game here.
Well, you can apprentice, he's going to portal and see what he gets here.
Yeah, not enough mana to play Deathwing. Faceless.
Okay.
Not going to get the job done, so he's going to concede, and yet another, Callum, another 5-game series.
Our 6th out of 7 matches.
Yeah.
It's fine, we're only 1 hour and 15 minutes behind schedule.
Is that it? I thought it was like 2 hours by now or something.
No.
Okay.
We were supposed to start the final game 1 hour and 15 minutes ago.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so we're a little bit more than an hour and 15 minutes behind schedule.
I mean, sure. Yeah. But yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, series is tied up 2 games to 2. And so what do we have as the remaining decks now? We have that really interesting Reno Lock build from Life Coach going up against Purple's...
Warrior.
Interesting. So, yes, we have established that he is an avid patron player. He has had success winning DreamHack with that deck in his lineup, if I remember correctly. So, patron probably going to have a moderately bad time against this version of the deck. There is that extra mid-rangey stuff, more big minions that you can taunt in the mid-game with the Fugin and Stalag and the potential of the burst, but it's definitely a winnable matchup for Patron, and if it ends up being Control Warrior, that's probably slightly more favored, but still the Warlock has every chance in that matchup, just because of the Warlock hero power just being so dominant against Control. But oftentimes in when I've seen that match played recently at a high level, the Warrior player is able to starve out any Warlock deck that doesn't have Jiraxxus in it, and Jiraxxus is not a card that we've seen from Life Coach so far.
Yeah, and given that he's put the combo and all the AoE and Fugin and Stalag in there, I'd be very surprised if we saw Demons as well.
Yeah. And it's just kind of the nature of the combo version of the deck means that you do just play less stuff for Warrior to have to deal with, so there's definitely an out for a Control Warrior just to be able to deal with all your stuff one by one, and it is Control Warrior from Purple.
Yeah, interesting. So we see the Shield Maiden Shield Slam, which of course, a huge tool to deal with any kind of minion threat.
Who's a huge tool? What?
A huge tool.
Ah, okay.
To be able to deal with threats. Gets the Shield Maiden back again there as well.
Alright, So he does have the Deathbite, which is, you know, that
one. He kept
one...
the Deathbite as well.
Yeah, he kept the Deathbite, which is the one card that, you know, Warriors are pretty much always happy to see in their opening hand, regardless of the variant of Warrior that you're playing and regardless of the matchup that you're up against. Deathbite is almost always good to have in your opening hand, especially when you're on the coin. It's going to be, in my opinion, one of the biggest misses in all of Standard format. Deathbite being taken out of the game is just such a huge deal. There is going to have to be some sort of help for Warrior given in the new set that comes alongside it, because that is a huge sacrifice to give up. It's just such a huge card. One of the most powerful cards in the game, honestly.
Yeah, I think the two decks that really suffer the most, and you know, everyone's talking about Dr. Boom and Piloted Shredder, but really, I think Mad Scientist in Freeze Mage, and to a lesser extent, but more Deathbite in Warrior. It's no card that's being removed in Standard is more of a linchpin in these decks than Deathbite and Warrior.
Right. Interesting that you bring up Freeze Mage losing Mad Scientist, because generally I think Freeze Mage will actually benefit. Honestly, I'm not a fan of doing these predictions because we don't know.
We talked about this earlier.
Yeah, we don't know what the new set is, right? So it's just not a wise thing to do. But sure, they lose Scientist, but also Lotheb and Antique Healbot are being cut out of the game, as well as all the sticky Death Rattle minions that don't die to like Frost Nova Doomsayer and Blizzard, etc. So I think Freeze Mage actually comes out way ahead when you consider it all.
Well, we will see that in future tournaments, but in this tournament, we see an early Armorsmith for purple, and Life Coach does have the in-game boss as well, opted not to play the Peddler last turn.
Yeah, interesting stuff. Not sure what the consideration was there. I guess just maybe didn't want to give a Fiery War Axe target if there was a Fiery War Axe in hand, but now he kind of encounters the same problem with the Imp Gang boss, where he gives his opponent a Deathbite target if that comes out. So honestly, if the Dark Peddler did come down and it got War Axed, you can then follow that up with the Imp Gang boss, and your opponent kind of has the wrong weapon equipped to be able to deal with that threat. So I don't really see the merit in not playing Peddler there on curve. It's put him in a bit of an awkward situation now, where his Imp Gang boss just kind of gets immediately farmed if there is a Deathbite in the opening hand, which, let's be honest, there always is, right?
Yeah, and it would have put him in potentially, you know, there's quite a few one drops he could have picked up that would have helped against this Armorsmith. There's Soulfire, there's Power Overwhelming, there's Abusive Sergeant.
Yeah, right, because if there was no War Axe and the Armorsmith was played, he'd have a 2-2 on board that he can then use that one mana card to tempo up into. So, yeah, strange decision, but he's going to continue tapping here, which, like I said, I can imagine the mentality here is, as I said, the Warlock hero power is basically the game-winning factor on its own in a lot of control matchups. So maybe Life Coach is just of the opinion that tap, tap, Drake here is a much better line than just playing out minions that can potentially die to the weapons that Warrior plays. So I can't really dispute this too much overall. Purple going to go ahead and slam his own Acolyte here, which is much more of a patron play than it is a control Warrior play, but he just feels like he wants some resources in his hand right now.
Does have an execute, of course, to deal with this Drake.
Yep.
Very easily. We see Bash coming to the hand as well, so lots of tools for Purple here in this deciding game.
Yeah, for sure. There's the Alexstrasza, which will definitely help out a little bit in this matchup. Sometimes the Alex can seem a little bit superfluous in the combo Reno locks, because you kind of work them down early with your minion presence anyway. But against Control Warrior, where your minions will mostly just be removing the Warrior's armor over and over again, the Alexstrasza is actually pretty helpful to be able to set up the combo kill.
So here in turn 5, no 5-drop other than the Faceless, which I don't think Life Coach is going to want to play Faceless and Armorsmith.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure you don't want a 5-mana Armorsmith right now. So he is going to play out the Dark Peddler now, with no other threats presenting themselves in hand. But you know, having looked at it, I don't mind his line of just playing the game more Handlock style and doing the tap, tap, Drake thing, as opposed to playing out the minions that can just get dealt with by War Axe and Deathbite, respectively. But that execute did just quickly put an end to that plan, and it looks like he's going to play both the minions in one turn here, which is smart the way this has ended up working out for him, because now obviously both of these minions can't be destroyed in one turn by a weapon.
Yeah, as you say, you know, Life Coach is a very thoughtful player, as a player who thinks possibly more turns ahead than any other player in the game.
Yeah,
and I think when he was looking at the Peddler and the Imp Gang boss, he was clearly thinking, I want to tap and do the Drake, and then, you know, I can play those on turn 5 and they can't both die to Deathbite, as you said. And you make your opponent play Deathbite off curve as well.
Yeah, I mean, small victories.
These are considerations.
Yeah, small victories, right? Anytime you can choke one of your opponent's mana crystals, then...
Life Coach is... I talking about those small victories, I once had a conversation with Life Coach about changing decks and working on how he works on deck lists and how he analyzes changes to decks and at the micro level. This was when I was doing interviews for the Kinguin Pro League. And he was saying, when I'm changing a deck, even if I change one copy of a card and it affects the win rate, that one card, and I draw it, say, 50% of games, that's like a 2-3% difference in I draw that card versus not having had it in the deck. So 2-3%, I draw that card more, and does that influence the game?
Yeah.
Does it improve my win rate a little bit? If it does, that's 2-3% better my deck is. And I was like, yeah, okay, I just about follow what you're saying. But for him, it really is about that micro level of making sure his decks are so finely tuned.
Right.
Like every card in his deck, he knows why it's in his deck, because this works better in this situation that I did in testing 5 times. It's a crazy level of preparation. So how do we deal with this here? We just go with the Death Spite. Seems good. Get some armor. Double Bash in hand. Is Double Bash standard now?
Bash has become pretty standard. I think people have accepted that it's just a really powerful card. There's more lists running two of them than not, for sure. It was a card that people were split on early on when Bash came out. People were, do we really need this? We have all these weapons. Do we need the Bash as well? But turns out it's just such a fantastic synergy with what Warrior is about now, which in a lot of matchups is just armoring your opponent out of the game with Justicar and Shield Maidens and Bashes, etc. And just having that extra insurance policy in the early game or in the mid game of, you miss a weapon to deal with, say, a Knife Juggler or the front half of a Pilot Shredder, having that Bash as the extra insurance in your deck is just particularly valuable. So, short answer to your question, yes, Double Bash is pretty much standard.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Oh, it gets the 4-roll on the Sludge Belcher. So nice suite of imps now on the board. I like that word, sweet.
Suite of imps. Is that the proper collective noun, Callum? Do I have to get out my collective noun dictionary?
You used it for traps earlier, which I thought was nice. The proper the collective noun for Hearthstone traps is a suite.
Yeah.
Well, there's the Reno, so that tool is now available to Life Coach. I find this a really interesting dichotomy now, Reno versus Warrior. Because for a long time, there was kind of an idiom in Hearthstone, or a conventional wisdom, that in a very control-heavy matchup, we see the Elise in the Warrior of Purple, very like the deck we saw from Eloise earlier,
yes.
Right?
Very good, yeah. Yes. Nice. You separated those two names very nicely there, Callum.
But yeah, there was sort of a conventional wisdom that in a control mirror, say Warrior versus Priest, Warrior had an inherent advantage because it could heal above 30.
Yes.
But actually, when you take that to the Reno level of being able to heal, so you can go down so far and heal so much back up.
Yeah.
I don't know how much that does make a difference, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, Reno definitely does equalize the playing field to an extent. The problem is that if the game does go that deep, where you're really worried about how much total health you have at the end of the game, you're in a situation where... the Warlock has spent the entire game life tapping, so they're going to hit fatigue so much faster. And the Reno is a heal once, but if you get into the position where the thing that brings you down to like 10 or 12 HP is fatigue for 7, for example, like what does Reno do in that situation, right? Like it keeps you alive for like 3 more turns, maybe.
Yeah, that's true. So we'll see if we do get some Golden Monkey action in this game. I was very disappointed we didn't get to see Elise.
Yeah, interesting that this is another Elise Warrior deck. It makes sense. You often see when these Warrior decks come down to the fatigue kind of games that we're talking about, that they're stuck with one or two useless cards in their hand that never got used. Maybe a Whirlwind, maybe a Revenge.
An Acolyte of Pain that you can't play anymore.
Yeah, that's that kind of thing. So Elise can definitely turn all those cards into more high-value things that can swing the situation.
Yeah, Lord Walker Cho, Nat Pagel.
Wilfred Fizzlebang, once you're out of cards, always good value.
The Annoyatron's pretty nice. It's always kind of nice to see an Annoyatron come from a Shredder, unless you're playing against Priest. Because it does just frustrate your opponent, and oftentimes they're trying to trade into your Shredder and then trade into something else. And yeah, at least when you're playing at the ranks that I am. And they trade into the Shredder first, and then it messes up the rest of their trades.
Yep. Noitron definitely, you know, there's the generally just standard, you know, Millhouse, Mana Storm, Succubus, etc. off Shredder that are always awesome, but then there's like these niche cards that are sometimes fantastic. And that's, you know, like the Annoyatrons, the Unstable Ghouls, the Explosive Sheeps.
Bluegill.
Bluegill Warrior, Whirling Zap-O-Matic sometimes is insane.
Patient Assassin.
Right, yeah. But Annoyatron is definitely in that sort of category where sometimes it just can be a really, really top tier 2-drop and it drops off of Shredder.
It's the problem with RNG, straight RNG versus Discover, I guess. Imagine if it was Discover a 2-drop for your opponent's board.
Right.
You could choose. Would that be fair? So then you don't end up getting Annoyatrons when you're trying to do stuff. I don't know. But then you just pick Doomsayer every time it came up.
Yep, pretty much. Yeah, Life Coach is going to develop the Sylvanas here, which gives him the opportunity to see that, to do the same play we saw earlier, where you abusive sergeant your opponent's Slug Belcher in order to try and steal the other minion that they play alongside it. The difference this time is that we don't have the owl to do the job, and Purple's actually just going to outright refuse to play a second minion here to make that same kind of thing possible.
Yeah, smart move from Purple. What do we have here from Life Coach? Well, he has the Thorisson, which would hit a pretty full hand. So, and we do know he has the combo, and he has two pieces of the combo in his hand, and also an Abusive Sergeant as well, which could be very relevant for the combo.
Interesting. I just caught Twitch chat out of the corner of my eye, and they believe they've caught a guaranteed lethal in that turn where I was talking about the Twisting Nether thing. Apparently, a combination of Shadow Flame and Demon Wrath would have been able to clear the board and get the Boombots to hit phase guaranteed. So, be interesting to go back and look at that, see if Life Coach did miss lethal. But if he did, I mean, it sounds legit from what I'm looking at Twitch chat. So, if so, good job, chat. He did it.
Good job, Twitch chat.
Yeah.
We love you.
Yeah.
Actually, Life Coach looking at the Arcane Golem here, not keeping it for the combo. That's interesting. Well, you know, there's no good way to deal with it with the Sylvanas, I guess, so just going to go ahead and use it here.
Yeah, just going to try and protect his Sylvanas on the board, I guess, to be as annoying as possible and just hope his opponent doesn't have a removal for it. Drams down the Emperor as well, but we do see Shield Slam is in the hand right now. And armor up.
Two shield slams.
Yeah, two shield slams, sorry. So armor up and shield slam both targets alongside playing a shield maiden this turn seems pretty solid. Because he does have to get rid of the Sylvanas first before the shield maiden's play.
Yeah, I was going to say, normally you'd be like, oh, shield maiden, shield slam.
Yeah.
Easy. Makes sense.
But you don't want to pull a Pavel in this situation, as it's colloquially known.
Oh, poor Pavel.
Yeah. But, you know, just gets himself a nice
Did Pavel win a tournament recently as
Did
well?
Did he? I'm not sure.
I thought, didn't he beat the, he beat Oskaka in one of the tournaments, didn't he?
Did he? I honestly don't know. If he did, I didn't catch it.
He's played so many tournaments recently, I lose track.
So the power overwhelming pickup, now that Life Coach has committed to using the Arcane Golem for ball control, using the power overwhelming here for ball control doesn't seem terrible either. He does, now that the charge minion has gone, the potential for power overwhelming and faceless is pretty much out the window. So he may just decide to make the tempo play here, trade the 1-1 into the 5-5, and he can even just go ahead and Alex face this turn if he'd really want to, having seen two of the premium removals used already on the previous turn.
It's the Hearthstone Champions League.
Ah, that's
right. Good. I'd say nice. You'd want something. It really does feel like there was over January was quite a quiet time for Hearthstone, and it feels like this month and next month, things are really ramping up. I mean, there's three events this weekend.
Right.
There were three last weekend, or was it just the two?
Yeah, and then we're kicking into like NA and EU finals very, very soon as well for the
ACC. Recently announced True Silver Championship is coming back at the end of next month.
And so it looks like the Alex to face play is happening, and yeah, it is the tempo play I described. So he's gone ahead and used his power overwhelming here just to take control of the board. Looks like he might play the Sun Fury Protector here. Just to get that extra presence on the board. And having seen the two shield slams used on the previous turn, he's feeling relatively confident that this Alexstrasza gets to stick unless there's an execute and an activator. No such luck from Purple.
But you can see that from all the armor from the shield maiden and the arming up, Purple is already back above 30 life. Which is it's a little bit of a problem with Warrior.
Yep. Just Warrior things. Get Alex to still be chilling at 31. Seems reasonable. Looks like Life Coach gravitated towards the Demon Wrath there. He can Demon Wrath, trade the Cleric, trade the Sun Fury Protector and Mortal Coil here to get rid of the 5-5 if he wants to. He may be considering just facelessing an 8-8 here, just to have maximum pressure on the board, but he is also probably a little bit worried about playing into Brawl, but two individual 8-6s, as this board will end up as, is a nice board to have against Brawl, to be perfectly honest.
Alright, so, I mean, Reno is an option here for half health. You can also heal bot as well.
Yeah. But it looks like he's going to start with jamming this 8 into face, and he was definitely considering the Demon Wrath to take out this 5-5. It looks like he's turned it down, and he is just going to go ahead with the Reno here. Take another, the 15 health heal.
Another option potentially, what do you think about facelessing the Alexstrasza?
Yeah, that was something that I was talking about while you were distracted doing whatever you were doing there, Callum. He could have facelessed the Alexstrasza and then Demon Wrath Mortal Coiled to take care of the 5-5, so he would have ended the turn with two 8-6s on the board.
And that's what minion you were talking about.
Yeah.
My problem.
Would have seemed pretty solid, but he chooses just to go with the Reno here, get himself nice and secure on the board. And nice and secure in terms of life total, at least. And he still has plenty of decent faceless targets left in his deck, I would imagine.
Well, I mean, he just pulled one of them, Dr. Boom, a second 7-7 is not bad either.
Yep, even facelessing a 5-5 Lothab, if it goes that way, is reasonable. And of course, you are playing against Control Warrior, so you expect that they will have big minions for you to faceless at some point as well. For example, if you can threaten your opponent to have to use Grom for board control, then faceless on that is very likely to end the game.
Absolutely. So what do you favor here? Do you go for the Dr. Boom or do you look at the Lotheb first?
It's difficult. The Lotheb would potentially push more damage because you've gone through a large portion of your opponent's deck without seeing a Brawl here, which this is a little bit exposed to. He's going to go ahead and Mortal Coil the Boombot here, which pushes damage to face straight away and actually plays around Brawl a little bit. So that's a pretty decent play from Life Coach. I like it, because now you're reducing the outcome of a Boombot surviving from 50-50 to 1 in 3.
Yeah, and if you don't get the really good Brawl, if you do go for the Brawl here and it doesn't really work out for you, you can be punished with a Lothab Sludge Belcher to protect whatever survived.
Yep. Yeah, I like it. He's gonna go for the Kit Kat Strat, dumps the Armorsmith. He's going to go for the Brawl, and we'll see if the prophecy is true. No, the 7-7 lives. Does have the execute to be able to take care of it, but he is down to a Grommash Hellscream and a Dream in his hand right now, and the Dream is not going anywhere fast.
Yeah, I mean, having the execute is good, but it means that he has to use that Deathbite charge, which he was clearly saving for Grommash.
Yeah.
How many other activators is he going to have in his deck?
I mean, I don't know how much of a consideration the Deathbite Grom was at that point when your opponent is still hovering out at 28 life, but
If it's the only win condition you've got because you've got no board.
Yeah, but I imagine there is still, for example, maybe another Slam in the deck, Cruel Taskmasters, etc. So there are other activators, but it's probably looking to hold on to that Deathbite for more value than what he got is the key point. There's a lot of things that he could have used. He could have used it on a better board. He could have used it to cycle Acolyte while he was out of cards. The big game Hunter Troll. Oh, dear. And, yeah, it looks like this is the situation we discussed before. Do we have lethal here? So we enraged the Grom, we faceless the Grom. That's 15 damage, and you can Argus for an additional 2. So you're just a little bit short here. Wait, no, you can Demon Wrath to enrage the
Grom. Yeah, that's just what I was going to say. You can use the Demon Wrath to enrage
So this is lethal, just Demon Wrath, faceless.
Faceless the Demon Wrath.
It doesn't matter, the ordering's the same. So
18, and then you Argus for an extra 2, so that takes you 1 over. Life Coach is going to advance to our top 8. Only way after we were supposed to be finished.
That's alright. He played pretty well. There was a little bit of Heart of the Cards early on in the Druid game where he just believed in that Innovate or Wild Growth coming off the top of his deck, but he got rewarded for going for it, was able to clutch out a pretty insane turn 4 lethal, or turn 4 concede from his opponent anyway. So yeah, pretty crazy stuff. And then that really interesting Reno lock build with the twins as well as the full combo suite as well.
Yeah, but really interesting.
I said suite again. I used to say package, but that tends to arouse Twitch chat. So.
Especially if you say combo package.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So I've gone with suite instead. I think it's a more pleasing word.
Yeah, with the Demon Wrath and all the AoE as well, and the Siphon Soul, all the removal, it would be really interesting to see that list and see what's not there. Mm. You do sometimes, I do enjoy that, every so often in casting tournaments, you'll see a deck and you'll see cards you don't necessarily see, like Actually, the Antonidas Freeze Mage, I first saw it in China. And I remember looking at a Freeze Mage list and going, oh, well, that it must not have this in it. And every time I said that card would then get drawn.
Yeah.
And eventually I was like, he doesn't play Antonidas and doesn't play Second Blizzard, I think was the other thing. But yeah, it was really random. And yeah, you sometimes see lists where you're like, how are all these cards in this deck?
Right.
I don't quite understand.
Yeah, 40 card deck syndrome. Sometimes you look at all this stuff your opponent's playing, you're like, what the? Like, does he just have like 45 cards in his deck? What's going on? And that Life Coach build of Reno is definitely one of those situations. He seems to have managed to pack in everything. Even Sun Fury and Argus we still see in there. The Sludge Belcher we still see in there. So all the core stuff is still in there, but he's managed to somehow find a way to pack those extra win conditions in.
Well, we have one more match left for today, Salto. It's been a long day. We're quite deep into it now, speaking of arousing Twitch chat. But we have one final game. And how do you feel about the 2014 World Champion coming along and... a longtime member of Cloud9, perhaps, as his opponent. Maybe a nice tasty matchup to finish up the day. It's going to be Ecop versus Firebat. I should say, of course, this is the Wombology tournament brought to you by Womble.gg, a website where you can play money matches against your friends and pro players and all the different esports games. Do you even esports game? Well, you can find out. Womble.gg.
Yeah, I believe I think Hearthstone, Dota, and CSGO are available right now, and they're adding support for Rocket League as well in the near future. So, Callum, I don't know if you're down for some Rocket League money matches, man. I mean,
I have to say, Rocket League's just come to Xbox, yeah. So we've got back into it, and
nice.
it's good. Yeah. And of course, our sponsor ScreenShoe as well. ScreenShoe.com allow you to take screenshots of your games within the game, and then there's an in-client editor as well, so you can like add notations, you can add. Pointing stuff out, and then you can easily share them to social media and share them to lots of different websites as well. It's a really cool little tool, so check that out as well. And of course, we will be back here tomorrow for the round of 8, and then the rest of the semi-finals and the final for our $6,000 prize pool. And everyone who wins the first round tomorrow, they're in the money, so we'll get to that point there. We're going to take a very short break before we come back for our last game. I promise it will be short, because we are aware that for those of you to the west of us, we're here in the UK, to the west of us, we're wishing you a happy Sunday now.
Yeah.
So we will just make it a few minutes, and then we'll be back here to bring you our final game of the day, Ecop versus Firebat. So go recharge your glasses and get ready for our final game. You're watching Wombology with Callum Leslie and Saltle.